Bad movie drinking game. 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 Bad movie drinking game.
He was a reformed ex-con who wanted to start a new life. She was the girl of his dreams.
Welcome home, convict. Hey, sis.
But between them and happiness...
What do you want from me?
I read your letters, convict.
...stands a team of criminals who wanted to take down the state's richest casino.
Finally meet a boy that I'm crazy about, and my brother wants him worse than I do.
Behind the wheel.
Ben Affleck, Gary Sinise, Charlize Theron. In the thriller from John Frankenheimer.
Game's over. Not yet.
Welcome to Bad Movie Drinking Game, the show where we watch bad movies for you and develop a drinking game for you so you can enjoy the film at its fullest potential. My name is Kurt, and with me are my friends Marcus, Sam, and Franklin.
Hello.
We are going to watch
Reindeer Games.
This is a fantastic film. This is our A Christmas Story. If anybody tells you, oh man, I can't wait to watch A Christmas Story, tell them it'll be on for 24 hours a day. Save yourself 2 hours. 2.5 hours?
About an hour and 40. Man.
It's 2 hours. And watch Reindeer Games. This is awesome. It's got so many things, all right? It's got Ben Affleck when he was terrible. It's the last big screen film by... a little guy named John Frankenheimer. It's got probably the last time I saw Isaac Hayes in a movie. Spoiler alert. It's also amazing. It's about Christmas, selfless.
It happens at Christmas. It's not really about Christmas.
The meaning of Christmas. It's not as much about Christmas as Die Hard is, but...
Right.
Let's not make comparisons. Look, it's just not fair.
It is so Christmassy, it came out in February.
If it wasn't for Christmas, by the way... the McLean marriage would have broken up many years before it finally did. Christmas and a series of terrorist attacks kept that couple together for a lot longer than they should have been.
But we digress.
We digress, because this is Reindeer Games, and it is amazing.
It's a movie about double crosses and triple crosses and...
crossroads.
Lies and deceit.
One of those crosses is for baby Jesus.
Yeah.
Yes.
Did you see this in the theater, Franklin?
I saw it in the theater.
You have a special place in your heart for... Christmas movies that don't have anything to do with Christmas or the spirit of Christmas. What did you think about this when you first saw it?
I really enjoyed it whenever I saw
really?
It.
Really?
I didn't know any better.
So it was like Armageddon. You really enjoyed it?
I didn't like Armageddon the first time I saw it.
This is what year did this come out? This
it
movie
came out 2000. So 2000. I would have snuck into it.
Oh, okay.
I can't remember what I would have paid for. Probably.
He's gonna remember this. Though.
Probably the Tigger movie.
The Tigger movie?
Which you also enjoyed, didn't you?
I didn't watch it, because I watched Reindeer Games.
I'm surprised. I thought you would have watched the Tigger movie.
I didn't.
You watched Piglet the Adventure, though, right?
No.
That's a shame.
Alright, so, Reindeer Games.
You can watch Reindeer Games by visiting your local Walmart, your local thrift shop.
Pawn shop.
Used movie dump bin.
Probably libraries.
You can probably steal it from an ex-girlfriend when she leaves. She won't notice. In all seriousness, you can find it on Amazon to purchase, or you can rent it through their instant video. It's only a couple bucks. It's worth it, guys.
Also, if Amazon wanted to pay us...
Wink.
It's got more twists than any movie I can think of that doesn't change what the movie is about.
I'd say maybe Wild Things, but this is probably right up there with that. It's pretty ridiculous at times.
I was gonna say we don't get any awkward nude scenes at the pool, but we do get an awkward nude scene at a pool.
We do. Yes.
Yeah. We do. All right, tonight's episode, Reindeer Games. I've been excited for this all week. This all right. is gonna be amazing. Let's get right into it.
First rule is gonna be anytime you hear a Christmas carol. Lots of mistletoe. Take a drink.
Mine is anytime they mention food.
A piece of pecan pie.
I want some hot chocolate.
I can really go for some onion rings.
Mine will be whenever you hear a Christmas-related pun.
When I get back in that room, you better be wearing nothing but a candy cane.
So you could get down her chimney.
Take a drink.
Whenever this character's in prison for a while, and he there's a series of letters written. Anytime someone mentions the letters,
should have written, Rudy. You'd have got yourself a girl.
I read your letters, convict.
Do you remember all those letters you wrote me?
It's gonna come up a lot. You're gonna take a drink.
Next, anytime there is a twist or there is a new character reveal, you'll take a drink.
And when the film's title is uttered on screen, one of my favorite things to happen in any film ever, wherever you're at in your drink, finish it. That's right.
To the top!
Grab your drinks, sit back and relax, and if you don't drink, like our friend Marcus here, grab yourself a nice big bag of Christmas cookies. You'll see why. Sit back, relax. Ben Affleck's real masterpiece, honestly, Reindeer Games. I don't know what to do with my hands.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Affleck face.
I have no
drink.
Drink.
Chum. It's just a rush. Yeah, it's protein. It's good for you. What?
If you wanted to draw more attention to yourself, wear a shady disguise.
She was in House of the Dead!
Yes, she was.
Everybody, 23rd, whatever.
We made it.
God damn it.
It went full circle. Wait for it.
No!
Man, they got a shitload of cookies.
Damn right we do. Indeed they do, sir.
And that was Reindeer Games. Guys, that was amazing. I don't know about you guys.
You all sold the Christmas spirit now.
I am
overflowing.
I'm bursting at the seams. I am the cuppeth overfloweth, man.
It runneth over.
It runneth over with games that reindeer play.
It got runneth over by truckers.
Yeah, what is with that?
Brick stupid truckers.
Let's go right into the film. Let me take off my viewing glasses. Because we've seen this before. What was the thing that you took away from this that you don't remember before or was new to you when you watched it this time?
The moral of this is trust no one except maybe family.
Nope. Don't even trust them.
Well, his actual family was cool, but people who claim to be family, you can't trust them.
And Charlize Theron and Gary Sinise weren't family.
Yeah,
so,
that's true. So people that claim to be family may not be family. Yes. But
by the way, we should say, spoilers ahoy, I'm sure you know that already, but some things were revealed in this film.
And then more things were revealed.
And other things unveiled.
Yes.
What's going on with this? So the sort of unspoken bit of logic of this film is that
logic. Okay.
The truckers that kidnap Ben Affleck are not smart at all. They're complete idiots.
Well, neither is Ben Affleck.
Yeah, like that's the thing that really stands out to me most about this movie, and it's not a new revelation as much as just reconfirmation that everything about this and everyone in it is just so fucking dumb.
It's like a Coen Brothers movie played straight. In the sense that it's about nothing but idiots.
Yeah,
trying
Raising Arizona
right.
was in fact not
trying
a comedy.
To outwit one another.
If you get Gary Sinise instead of Steve Buscemi, this is what happens.
And then Ben Affleck instead of George Clooney.
What do you guys think about Gary Sinise as our villain?
He took his role very, very seriously.
I remember I was watching the film Casino with a mutual friend of ours, a little man named Dave. And hi, Dave, if you're watching. I remember it was the shot where it's like the camera pans across Joe Pesci's gang. And I remember he was like, oh, my God, he looks so big, even though he's such a little man. This villain, Gary Sinise plays a villain in this who looks so much smaller than he actually is. He looks so tiny. There's a part of this movie, there's a scene in particular where he's sitting.
Really messed up.
He's
part
sitting
that he's in these sleeveless shirts to show how much he's worked out. Too.
Yeah, because he drives a truck. He's sitting on top of a jukebox and he hops off of it and he's like a full foot shorter than that. And such a small little man, and oh my, I think Charlize Theron's taller than he is.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. She's no monster.
I mean, I'm fine with that. I'm just saying.
That's good, because there are monsters in the gelatin.
That is the best scene in the entire movie, and that's not a bad thing.
So, and it connects to the overall convolution of our plot.
Yeah. So early in the film, while we're still in prison with Ben Affleck and Weird Face, the Isaac Hayes is just a random prisoner who...
He doesn't currently have his tinfoil hat.
They took that away from him. But he discovers that apparently the entire batch of Jell-O in the building has been cooked with a family. It's been chilled with a family of cockroaches inside of it. Like,
and
everybody
at least 5 to 10 minutes to realize that there was at least one in their tray.
Do you think that was supposed to happen? Do you think that was a setup to cause the riot?
I was curious. Like, but the plan clearly said that they weren't expecting the riot.
That they were
so.
Like,
a chef was just a dick and put a bunch of roaches in there.
There's monsters in the gelatin, and then it just starts a prison riot because of it. He's not even outraged. The other prisoners are outraged and start attacking the guards. He's just in shock.
And his action in that scenario is to just not just repeat that particular line, but then to mount the table and then just raise his tray as if he's almost leading the riot in some kind of way, but not really.
Yeah. Well, I love though that the villain in the prison is this guy that thinks that Ben Affleck ratted him out and that's why he ended up in solitary.
Which
but we
they dump on us in the most expository dialogue.
But then they come back to it later and it turns out he was paid to fake stab his cellmate. But it's like he's like, he was supposed to stab me in the yard later that day, but that prison riot happened. And then he like trails off, and it's like the next sentence would have been like, and ever since those prison improv exercises, he yes-anded the shit out of that prison riot. He was like, I'm going to use this.
It was clearly his plan to get this guy to stab him later in the day, but he just had this fake blood thing with him the whole day?
Yeah, just in case something, an opportunity presented itself earlier, which it did.
But he also then tries to stab Ben Affleck, which he wasn't supposed to do, as far as I can tell.
I think he's been taking acting classes in prison.
He got lost in the moment.
Yeah.
That's like
overcome with this joy of stabbing.
That's like that part in Apocalypse Now when Martin Sheen just punched that mirror and was like, aah!
There's a lot really of similarities between this and Apocalypse Now.
Yeah, they both
in that. No, there's none.
No, listen, they both end with fiery explosions, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I get it, that one.
They both...
Yeah, you're done, aren't you?
There's that scene in Apocalypse Now where they're eating, like, krill or, like... Or they kind of look like cockroaches. Exterminate with extreme prejudice.
That one shot we get of Nick, the cellmate. Can you imagine how awkward it would have been whenever he pulls out the blood capsule to put into his mouth if someone saw him?
Yeah.
Like, what if someone just came up and said, hey.
Did that dude just put a prune in his mouth?
What are you doing?
He's like, are you eating a balloon?
You ain't dying.
Is that a balloon baggie or something? What are you doing?
You ain't dying at all.
Completely. He's like a dick in a magic
screw
show.
Up the whole idea of him faking his death because there's nothing believable about it other than that bullshit packet that he apparently had. Because that's not going to convince any kind of medical exam.
No, he paid off the guards.
He probably went to the clinic.
He got
they just gave him some stitches or whatever. And they would have sent him back, but he bribed enough people to just... He just bribed that one guard to go and say, hey, your roommate's dead, bye.
He's got that much money to bribe that many people.
I know. I'm not trying
everything
to,
about
I'm not trying to fill in
sense.
All the holes. I'm just trying to explain what could have happened.
Oh,
and almost every turn in this movie, Gary Sinise is constantly rambling about how tough it is being a truck driver, or how it makes you hard.
15 hours a day.
Yeah, he's got a whole dart throwing monologue about how rough it is.
But it's like he's talking about, like, I'm in fucking Russian prison, man. I've been lifting stones for 15 years in the darkness. You know, like, you're like, no, you've been driving a truck. Like, it's not rocket scientists. It's not.
Stallone could handle it.
I saw no weightlifting machine.
And they would have taken it over the top.
Don't play no reindeer games with me.
There are some choice bits of strange... we've quoted a few. Just strange dialogue. Like, the tone of this film is not really comedic.
Oh, man, the way they force fuck the title into the dialogue in this movie.
Well, yeah, they're constantly making holiday puns.
Oh, throughout, but that one in particular was probably the worst, just because of how unnatural it is for anybody to bring up reindeer games.
I always wonder if there was a heist script just written, and they're like, we gotta make it interesting, we gotta spice it up. Well, let's set it at Christmas.
Pumpkin spice it up.
Let's make it Christmas themed.
Yeah.
Cause why not?
It worked for Die Hard.
Yes.
We'll have a heist movie set at Christmas.
How awesome would it be to have a poster with five Santas on it?
Yeah.
Holding guns.
I just found that there was a criminal waste of acting talent. I mean, Dennis Farina's character,
they're all criminals.
He's given, like, you know, a good 1.5 to 2 dimensions. Like, he's a casino guy, he's down in his luck, and he can't go back to Vegas.
Well, no, there's another layer. He's also a huge racist.
I don't...
Yeah, no, he says some mean
he
shit.
He does.
Literally everything he says about Native Americans is derogatory.
You gotta have a powwow. Get yourself a spirit dance.
I think he would say that exact same thing about any culture.
He's an equal opportunity racist.
You gotta find somebody's feet.
I think he's a very abrasive person.
We've got Isaac Hayes. Yeah. We've got Dennis Farina. Rest in peace. Love him. Both of them, by the way.
Donald Logue.
Right. Danny Trejo. Clarence Williams III, who is probably the highlight of the movie. Smoke a pot.
He has the most memorable death by far.
Does not want Ben Affleck to have a gun.
Because he doesn't like him.
Let's talk about Ashton Kutcher.
No, let's not talk about Ashton.
We don't have to because the movie didn't.
Yeah. So their ultimate plan is, even once they realize he's not the correct person and he doesn't really know what he's talking about, they're going to go ahead and knock over this casino anyway because they're invested for some reason.
He's got to know something. He was the guy.
But, so they put on their little Santa suits, and Gary Sinise is still wearing fingerless gloves, putting his fingerprints all over every surface in the room.
He's committed to those fucking gloves.
He works 15 hours at a time. He needs those to grip his gear shift.
Are you saying that his years spent driving a truck wore off his fingerprints?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Or at least his palms.
They vibrated them off with the, you know, it's like a rattly experience. Mm-hmm.
And then we get into double crosses and triple crosses.
The initial plan is girl hooks up with inmate who's supposed to help out gang of truck drivers who've never robbed anything anywhere, so that way they can rob a casino that inmate used to work at. But the supposed inmate is dead, so we've got Affleck taking his place and pretending to be the guy until it's inconvenient, and then pretending to be him again when it's convenient. All right, fine. But, oh wait, plot twist, she was in on it the whole time, and she's actually the girlfriend of the little man with the fingerless gloves.
Yeah.
Except... after they robbed the casino...
and most of them are dead.
She's not just lying. She's actually the first girlfriend of the prison roommate that he's been talking about. It's like, boy, thank God I met that girl. I wouldn't have ended up in prison and met this other girl. That's the same girl.
But here's the Millie thing that Bobak really kills me about this entire scenario. In order for this to actually sink in and work in any way, shape, or form, Nick, I'm guessing that's his real name?
Nick,
the
yeah.
villain from The Cape, if you ever get a chance.
No one saw that.
It's totally worth it. He would have had to have set this plan in motion years ago.
Oh, yeah.
In order to plant the seed and actually make this work in any way for Rudy, which is, I guess, the reason why this is titled Reindeer Games, to actually, like, buy into the idea of taking his place when he so-called dies.
Hey, ma'am. Watch your mouth, it's Christmas.
The movie is really well composed from a visual standpoint. The script is terrible, but like, it's weird watching a movie
be
fairly well directed and have tons of talented people behind it, and it's just like, what is happening? It's not confusing. It just feels like
it's
like
when lots of dumb.
Yeah, it feels like when you get up, you're like, oh no, I forgot my keys. I gotta walk back to the other side of the road. Oh look, there's another thing. All right, when I'm ready to go, no, I forgot my keys in the first place. Like, it just feels like someone moving back and forth in a room, not knowing what they're doing.
There is an ongoing theme in that there were monsters in the gelatin. Our our truck driving villain, his nickname is Monster, which is also on his truck. And Charlize Theron was in Monster.
Trifecta.
If only they had Monster Energy drink in 2000, which I don't think they did.
We were still trying to thrive off a rock star back then.
Surge.
I just love that his character is a grown-ass man with three male friends of diverse, ethnic origins. Good job, Gabriel. But he's a grown-ass man who makes his friends call him Monster.
And he's the smallest among them.
Yeah, it's short from Little Monster. Oh, he's a little devil. He's so mean. He's so cute.
My pet monster.
Nick the trick.
You would never notice so many details in half of these actors' faces if not for the way that this movie was shot.
Oh, yeah. And John Frankenheimer's like, I don't care what this... I'm not compromising. We're going to get a big face and a little face. And you're going to be like, what's happening in that big face? But pay attention to that little face. Because subtext.
The casino manager is probably the most fleshed out character.
Yeah, and that's
and that's sad because he's only got like two scenes.
And that's a testament to Dennis Farina. And everyone in this film is defined by like two to four facts about them. I'm a car thief. I really want to eat mom's turkey. Also, hot chocolate's good. Like,
and I like pie.
Yeah,
I'm a so much so that I will lie to a woman in order to get some.
Not yeah, just
you see what I did there?
Not just pecan. Bapuntang.
What?
Let's talk about Rudy for a minute here, because in no way, shape, or form,
I don't feel that he would have actually been a successful football player. I mean, at Notre Dame.
He was 5 foot nothing, 100 and nothing, but he played with his heart. Oh, man. And whenever they just
I mean, Sean Astin did a good job.
No, we are talking about a much better movie.
And whenever Rudy carries north up to Mount Doom and he drops that ring, oh, my God.
It's powerful.
Goosebumps.
Oh, man.
Speaking of Gollum, I did like his roommate, Nick.
Hey, give that guy a break, man. He's not bad.
He was bad in the cape, but all right, moving on.
There's really nothing in this entire movie that gives you any implication that our ex-con who we're following here actually reformed in any way and is thus a good enough person to actually earn a happy ending.
Well, I think we're supposed to believe he's reformed in prison.
He gives that one like line or two at the beginning, like, I'm sorry, Dad, I took the easy way out. Yeah. But now 5 years ago.
He still takes the easy way out.
Yeah, well, no, I think we're also supposed to love him because, and this is, I think, something I want to talk about, is the last shots of this film is him whistling Silver Bells, and he's walking home to his parents, still wearing the outfit he was seen in after he just murdered a bunch of people in a casino as part of a gang.
As well as robbed it.
And he's got bags full of millions of dollars, and he's just stuffing them into people's mailboxes on the way home. Noble. He's not keeping all that money. He's giving it away
but
to the good people of Michigan.
That makes them all an accessory to the crime he just committed.
But, and you know, I would, here's the most fucked up part about that. You know, it's almost like he's a weird anti-Indian vigilante.
Because it's really established that
this
that
is the Native American's money.
Right. And that particular casino was not doing very well. And it's on a reservation, so that kind of gives you the implication that they needed that money.
Getting back to Reindeer Games.
In an alternate universe where Reindeer Games won an Academy Award, what category would have to exist for it to win the Academy Award?
Okay. I can't get over this one, so I'm just going to have to go with the Reverse Robin Hood or the Du Nibor Award. For Ben Affleck, because he robs from the poor and then just gives to whoever the hell he can without thinking of consequences.
Yeah. People who own their own land, unlike some Native Americans.
Yeah. What a dick.
Mine would be set dressing for the most horrible hotel that could possibly exist in Michigan, because it looks like it's made entirely out of cinder blocks. It's like a medieval times that was converted into a crappy hotel. And it's got multiple floors because he's running up and down flights of stairs. And it's got shitty beds and black and white TVs.
And the archway over the
bed. Yeah.
we couldn't afford to, you know, do anything other than those beds we got. We put it all into the Street Fighter 2 pinball.
They're like the crappiest, barely bolted together pieces of metal beds.
This is some shit that you'd expect in a college campus from 86.
I would say this movie would win the award for best infomercial for Christmas dinner. It spends the entire movie selling you on the idea of what he's going to get at the end. Whenever he sits down and he gets his Christmas dinner.
I'm going to get me some turkey and some gravy right. and some cranberry. I fought off all these robbers in Santa suits. Now I get my turkey.
And you're right there with him and it looks delicious.
And, oh, that face.
The Academy Award for most postmodern avant-garde set design, similar to yours, but with a special attention on fake snow. Because there's a choice made where it's like, oh no, all the actors have fake snow glued to their face right now. It doesn't look convincing at all. Should we take that out? No. Leave it in. I want them to see it. Every film in every part of this movie has just fake snow all over the place. There's just, like, literally it feels like there's that scene in Kill Bill where they go and they fight on the fake snow with Orinishi. And I was like, that's straight up what he just walks into at the end, except there's a bunch of, like, radiators in the background. But there's just fake snow everywhere, and they fall in it, and they're all sweaty, but then, like, the snow sticks to their face, and it's
it
just...
It doesn't get their clothes wet in any way.
Nope.
This is a great movie to watch around Christmas if you're tired of watching heartwarming Christmas stories. Yeah. You're just sick of all the, like, ABC Family stuff. Like, oh, that feels great. It's like, this is a terrible movie full of terrible people, and there's nothing really redeeming about it.
If you don't have access to Die Hard.
Yeah. Let's say you've already watched Die Hard a time or two, and you're right. Like, well, I need to fill that, like 2 hours or hour and 40, depending on which version you get. Watch the short one.
I mean, it's fleshed out in the director's cut.
But, Like, that would be my takeaways. Like, I'm tired of the syrupy stuff. I want to see people die in ridiculous, stupid ways.
For Bad Movie Drinking Game, I've been Kurt. I might not be for that forever.
I'm still Marcus.
Sam.
Franklin.
This has been Reindeer Games. Watch it. It's really fun. Ben Affleck is terrible, and I feel that he's got a good future ahead of him. And why not celebrate his failure as that future begins?
And look out for truckers.
They're dangerous because they work hard and they play hard.
15 hours.
15 hours a day.
Really does feel like a movie that was supposed to be a comedy and they forgot to put the comedy in it and they're like, hey, it's a heist movie, we'll just make a heist movie
and then we'll add in the reindeer pun or the Christmas puns.
So many Christmas puns.
Man. I mean, do you just break out into spontaneous holiday puns at the holidays time?
I do, but that's more an affliction of mine.